Hi, I'm David Crow, and this is episode 242 of The Infectious Myth. Email me at david.crow@theinfectiousmyth.com. That's Crow with an E. Join the discussion and like us at facebook.com/theinfectiousmyth. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at infectiousmyth. Listen Tuesdays at 2 p.m. U.S. Eastern Time on prn.fm or subscribe to the podcast on iTunes or other programs. You can listen to any of the last five episodes over the phone by dialing the U.S. number 701-719-0990 and following the instructions. prn.fm has voicemail. Call 862-800-6805, and as well as a message or question for this show, leave your name and indicate that the question is for The Infectious Myth. If you dial either of these numbers, long-distance charges may apply. I don't know that you're a listener until I hear from you, and I love to hear from you, so send me a message letting me know how you stay in touch with the show and what you like about it. If you include your mailing address, I'll send you a little thank you gift, one of the bookmarks I make by hand using my own photographs. I do really love to hear from my listeners, so don't be shy. You can make a one-time donation to the expenses of the show via PayPal using the email david.crow@theinfectiousmyth.com or commit to monthly donations at patreon.com or liberapay.com, where we are also Infectious Myth, one word. We appreciate all our listeners, but if you want this show to continue to grow and improve, consider paying a small amount for the information that you are gleaning. One thing I'm sure you value is media that is independent of financial interests, such as Big Pharma. But producing media costs time and money, so if you truly believe this, you should make a contribution so that independent media can thrive. Not just The Infectious Myth, but other important independent podcasts and radio shows also. But don't forget us. If you'd like me to speak at a meeting of an organization you're a member of, on any topic you think I have an interesting and worthwhile opinion on, I'd be happy to discuss this with you. I appreciate you commenting and suggesting guests. I appreciate your financial support as well. Thanks for listening and for recommending this show to your friends. The good news is that I have a steady list of interesting guests lined up. The bad news is that I need to comment on the coronavirus epidemic, which in many ways is a repeat of the 2003 SARS epidemic, and I don't want to bounce my guests. I studied SARS intensely and have made my draft book chapter available for free at theinfectiousmyth.com/sars.pdf, SARS in all uppercase. What I found, based on published science, is that the disease was not nearly as infectious as believed, and that the worst outcomes occurred with the most potent medications, especially high-dose steroids and the antiviral drug ribavirin, and also with more invasive methods of respiratory assistance. What I found already with the coronavirus scare is that they are deliberately inflating the infectiveness of the epidemic, and that they have no idea about the false positive rate of their new test based on RNA detection. If the coronavirus test was 99% accurate, there would be about 100,000 people who would falsely test positive in a city like Wuhan, 10 million people. With numbers like that, it would be easy for doctors to convince themselves that there was an epidemic of disease, when actually it was just an epidemic of testing. Doctors appeared to have started off more cautious about treatments and respiratory assistance, perhaps because some of them remember what happened with SARS, but that appears to be changing as the panic increases. They are already trialing the old AIDS drugs lopinavir and ritonavir, something that was planned way back in 2003, and oseltamivir, aka Tamiflu, is being widely used despite a less than stellar track record. You can read this at theinfectiousmyth.com/book/coronaviruspanic.pdf with a capital C and a capital P. I'll put the links in the show notes, and I will update the coronavirus panic PDF as events develop. And now let's go to this month's interview, which is actually truly historic. You couldn't write a history of AIDS science without mentioning Harry Haverkos. Harry graduated in medicine from the Medical College of Ohio in 1976, did a residence at Akron City Hospital, also in Ohio, a fellowship in infectious disease at the University of Pittsburgh in 1981 and at the CDC in 1984. He was there when AIDS began. He joined the U.S. Public Health Service in 1981 as an epidemic intelligence officer at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention in Atlanta. At CDC, he initiated national surveillance for AIDS and participated in epidemiological studies among homosexual men, Caribbeans, hemophiliacs, and blood transfusion recipients. In 1984, he became a medical officer at the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, NIAID, which is part of NIH. After several positions there, he was appointed intramural physician scientist at the National Institute on Drug Abuse, NIDA. From 1989 to 2006, he served in the Infectious Disease Service Department of Medicine at Walter Reed Army Medical Center as a physician and educator. In 1998, he transferred to the Food and Drug Administration as a medical reviewer in the Division of Antiviral Drug Products, Center for Drug Evaluation and Research. He retired from active duty in August 2006 and served as a special volunteer in the Viral Epidemiology Branch at the National Cancer Institute from 2006 to 2009. He's currently an associate professor, preventive medicine and biostatistics, Uniformed Services, University of the Health Sciences, in Bethesda, Maryland. Apart from numerous scientific papers, in 2012, he published On the Front Lines of the AIDS Pandemic. Welcome to the show, Harry.
David, thank you.
So, first of all, could you explain your title of captain in the U.S. Public Health Service? And also, you talked about the uniformed services. So, why is a medical organization organized on kind of a military line?
Well, it turns out there are seven uniformed services in the United States, the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, the Marines, the Coast Guard, the Public Health Service, and the smallest group is NOAA, National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration.
Oh, okay.
So most people, you know, there are physicians in the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, you know, that provide medical care. The Public Health Service was actually established, the forerunner of it, in 1798. And so as our country developed after our separation from England, we weren't sure how to set up and fund a standing army or a standing navy, which were very important in wars at that time. So we actually, for an army, we set up our Second Amendment and allowed all men voters to bear arms. And mm-hmm. actually, they were responsible for having their own weapons and managing them. And if they didn't have a serviceable weapon, they could be fined. Similarly, for the Navy, we weren't exactly sure what to do, and so we set up a group of physicians, the forerunner for the Public Health Service. We actually knew we couldn't have a Navy, so we made some deal, apparently, with seafaring captains and whatever, mm-hmm. and we provided medical care for commercial seamen mm-hmm. and set up a whole system of Marine hospitals, the Marine Service, from that point forward. In the mid-1980s, the role for these physicians expanded. We did quarantine work, and then over time we did investigations of diseases and outbreak. For a while, we're actually in charge of the Veterans Administration. We run the Leprosy Center in the United States. We provide medical care to the Indian Health Service, Bureau of Prisons, and a lot of us work at NIH or FDA or the Centers for Disease Control.
Okay, well, that's some really interesting history that I did not know. You did forget Donald Trump's new Space Force, which is a new uniformed branch of the
Well, actually, that's part of the NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration.
Oh, really?
So there okay. are scientists in there, mainly engineers and others, marine biologists, meteorologists, and a number of the astronauts that are through that organization
okay.
of science.
Oh, okay.
And so, yeah, they'll include Air Force, just as, you know, I saw patients at the Army hospital. You know, we kind of intermix and work together.
Okay. Well, the reason we're talking today is really to talk about Kaposi sarcoma, a disease that was first described in 1872 by Morris Kaposi, a dermatologist. Did I say 1872? Let's talk about the symptoms of Kaposi sarcoma, and then maybe you can address whether it really is a cancer, because it's often considered to be a skin cancer.
Yeah, no, it was 1872. We had a couple of reports from this guy, Maurice Kaposi, who was a dermatologist at the University of Vienna, and he saw some hospitalized patients that developed extensive rashes. Some of these cancers or abnormalities occurred in the GI tract, in the lung. So they were skin, but also multi-organ developments. And basically what we see here is a abnormality of blood vessels.
Mm-hmm.
And so these blood vessels grow into tumors, and blood can seep out of the blood vessels. So we see things that look like bruises on the skin, skin rashes, extensive rashes, and then bleeding into different organs of the body. Since all organs have blood vessels, it can really affect any organ of the body.
Right.
But predominantly the skin and the GI tract and the respiratory tract.
It was a pretty obscure disease before it became one of the two first AIDS-defining diseases, although it was called gay-related immune deficiency, or GRID, back in 1981, I think. I just wanted to raise that as the significance of talking about this disease. It was found prior to the AIDS era. I had old men, some groups of Africans, and transplant patients. Is that basically where it was?
Yeah, well, let's go back. So 1872 was when Kaposi at the University of Vienna first described cases, and he discovered about 25 cases over 25 years mm-hmm. in Vienna and the surrounding areas that he wrote about. It was next found in Africa in about 1915, occurred. So the groups in Vienna were predominantly elderly men,
mm-hmm.
men over age 60, and they came in. They were hospitalized and developed these rashes that persisted. Many of them survived extensive periods of time before dying
mm-hmm.
of other diseases.
Right.
In Africa, we saw it predominantly in younger men and some in children, and in some cases took a more fulminant course with death.
Like a faster, more dangerous
what's
course.
That?
By fulminant, you mean it progressed faster and killed people.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. More rapidly than did the elderly male form of the disease in Kaposi's time. And then it was seen in the United States. We saw some elderly men with it, but we're starting seeing it among transplant recipients.
Mm-hmm.
In the 60s and the 70s.
Yeah, and transplant patients are given pretty powerful immunosuppressive drugs.
Exactly.
Right, such
exactly.
as nucleoside analogs in some cases.
They're given, a lot of steroids. And,
mm-hmm.
So the problem is when you give somebody a new organ, such as
right.
a kidney or a liver or a heart, our immune system generally will fight against that foreign tissue.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have to suppress the immune system so that the graft takes place. And so we saw some Kaposi sarcoma in this population as well. So prior to the AIDS problem, 1981, we saw about 300 cases of, we estimated about 300 cases of Kaposi sarcoma a year.
Mm-hmm.
And they were predominantly in elderly men or younger men or women who had renal transplants. or other transplants.
Mm-hmm. And is it a cancer?
Well, most people consider it a cancer, but it doesn't have all the characteristics of a cancer, such as it's very hard to find the actual cell of origin or the changing cell of origin. So it appears to, in many cases, to be multifocal. It'll appear in several skin lesions or several sites of the skin or other body areas. But I think most people consider it a cancer.
Does it ever, does it regress more commonly than other cancers?
It can regress, and interestingly, so among transplant recipients, if you can lower the immune suppressive agents that you're using, you can have it resolve.
Which indicates that maybe the drugs that the transplant patients were given were the cause or part of the cause?
Well, I would propose part of the cause, yes.
Mm-hmm. Were there theories about the causes in these groups of old men and Africans, again, prior to the AIDS era?
Yes, and the leading hypothesis was that it was a herpes virus, a specifically cytomegalovirus, that was proposed by an Italian oncologist, Gaetano Giraldo, who's out of Naples and who got very much involved in the AIDS pandemic, especially when it started appearing in Italy and because of the work he did in Africa. But he saw in the 1970s, now we're talking 1970s, not 1870s,
mm-hmm.
He saw on some of these tumors in Africa, specifically Uganda, electron microscopy saw a herpes virus and thought this herpes virus was most related to cytomegalovirus. At that time, the 1970s, we knew of five different herpes viruses, herpes simplex 1, oral herpes, or fever blisters, herpes simplex 2, the genital herpes virus, varicella zoster virus, the chickenpox shingles virus, Epstein-Barr virus, the virus that's associated with mononucleosis or kissing disease, and then finally cytomegalovirus, which is a virus that he thought was the virus that he saw on electron microscopy. So that was really the leading theory coming in for Kaposi's prior to the AIDS epidemic.
Okay, so if we get to AIDS, the first paper by Gottlieb was published in June of 1981, and I believe that just talked about PCP, Pneumocystis carinii pneumonia, which was the other of the two first AIDS diseases. But in July 1981, there was a paper on KS. Now, interestingly enough, we're going to talk about poppers and nitrite inhalants. The June paper noted that all five patients were heavy users of poppers, but there was nothing in the July 1981 paper about poppers use.
That's correct. Those were reports by a number of dermatologists got together in California for a meeting. Alvin Friedman Keene from New York City, Marcus Conant from San Francisco. There were some other, and they came up with 26 cases of Kaposi sarcoma among their patients. They were all gay. Almost all of them were white. I think there was one black gentleman in there.
Mm.
They were younger than we had expected from the surveillance before. I think the youngest was like 29 and or 26, and the oldest in that group was 51 of these 24 cases.
Right, and where were they finding the lesions in these men? Were there any patterns?
Yes, mainly in the skin, some in the internal organs, and mainly on the face and the chest.
Which contrasts, I believe, with old men, it was mostly on the lower extremities, the lower legs?
Yes, the African cases are predominantly on the legs. The mm-hmm. children is predominantly in the inguinal area, lymphadenopathy. But the elderly men prior tended to be more diffusely, but extremities more so than surely not the face and the chest.
So obviously when the first papers were published, there was probably a lot of speculation about what the cause was, and it's still somewhat controversial today, I think. But you started to do research on paupers and the relationship with Kaposi sarcoma, I believe, when you were still at NIAID.
Well, no, actually, so you actually gave the dates wrong in your preamble. Basically, I did graduate medical school in 76.
Mm-hmm.
I did 5 years of clinical training before joining the Public Health Service.
Right.
In July of 1981. So I became a commissioned officer. I was commissioned by Ronald Reagan July 4th of 81,
mm-hmm.
and started down at CDC in the Epidemic Intelligence Service.
Oh, okay.
It was actually assigned, well, I'll get to what I started on. So I didn't do research on paupers. I basically was doing research on AIDS. So I'm the guy that actually defined what AIDS was in July of 1981.
Was it called AIDS? No,
it wasn't called AIDS until about September of 82.
Okay.
We didn't call it GRID down at CDC. That was a name given to it by Mike Gottlieb in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
We actually said we were working on Kaposi sarcoma and opportunistic infections.
Mm-hmm.
And our original case definition did not include just two diseases, but actually we had 12 diagnoses that we were looking for. They included 4 parasitic infections. When I joined CDC, I was assigned to parasitology and then recruited to serve on a task force or a detail to work with Jim Kern and Harold Jaffe and others that started working on. It was called the Task Force for Kaposi Sarcoma and Opportunistic Infections.
So KS was actually the leading disease, because looking back, I think of PCP as the big one, and KS
yes,
was kind of...
So PCP occurred in about 60% of the early cases. Kaposi's actually, in the first year, about 60% as well. And many of these people had multiple infections.
Mm-hmm.
But we included 4 pneumocystis, parasitic disease. Actually, now we know it's a fungus. It's not a parasite.
Right.
Toxoplasmosis, infection of the brain. Strongyloides, a worm infection that passes through the lung and other organs of the body. And cryptosporidium, a diarrheal-causing infection, were the 4 parasites we counted as defining this new syndrome, the opportunistic infection.
So,
cytomegalovirus, herpes virus, progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, and we had 1 bacterial disease and 2 cancers, Kaposi sarcoma and lymphomas of the brain that were being reported.
Okay.
There from the beginning.
I imagine you had the medical diagnoses under control, but I also imagine that the role that paupers played in the gay community was probably new to you. I mean, what did you learn about why paupers are so heavily used in the gay community and what characteristics they have there?
Well, maybe we should run out a history of paupers.
Okay, that sounds good.
So let's go back to now 1859. Remember, mm-hmm. not 1959.
1859, okay.
1859, there were people that were studying a lot of chemistry at that time. Anesthetics were being developed. People discovered that amyl nitrite causes blood vessels to dilate.
Mm-hmm.
And so that drug was found. And in 1866, there was a Scottish medical student that said, gee, these things cause blood vessels to dilate. What if people that are having chest pains, which we think are due to narrowing of the arteries of the heart, what if we give them same old nitrite to sniff, will that cause their blood vessels to dilate and give them some relief from pain? And sure enough, that's what this guy, T. Louder Brunton, found. And so he then published his work a year later to worldwide. I mean, it was the first really treatment that affected chest pains.
Mm-hmm.
He then promoted this, and he actually went on and did work with a variety of other cardiovascular drugs over time. By 1890, this was the drug of choice to treat chest pains.
Mm-hmm. And was it is that when it got the name paupers, or was that later?
No, that was later. It actually, so 1890, it becomes the treatment of choice. It was also used diagnostically by cardiologists, by internists, by doctors, to try to figure out where heart murmurs were from. You know, now we stick dye into the arteries and are able to track, or actually through veins, but we can track the flow of blood and see where things are narrowed and or where murmurs occurred through echoes and different things. But back then, if you used paupers and the murmur was from the aortic valve, the valve where it goes from the left ventricle out into the aorta and rest of the body, if they sniffed paupers, it would affect the intensity of the murmur if it was aortic in nature, and it wouldn't affect if it was from the other three valves. So paupers were used as a therapy. Amyl nitrite, I should say, not paupers.
Mm-hmm.
Amyl nitrite, and also diagnostically. In 1960 is when the nitroglycerins developed. So the treatment of choice for chest pains switched from amyl nitrite to nitroglycerins. It turns out one of the problems with amyl nitrite is it's very flammable. So people, for example, that were smoking cigarettes and then got chest pains and took, you know, many of them burnt a number of things.
Okay.
So it was a major shift, a much safer product to use sublingual nitrates than the nitrites. Now, the name paupers came because these products used to come in ampules. And so what you would do is you'd develop chest pain, you'd take them out, and they were in little ampules. You would snap them or pop them and then release the liquid underneath your nose and sniff these to get relief, and that's how it was used. So they became known as paupers. And people found through the 60s and 70s that this also enhanced one's sex life. It was like an aphrodisiac for some people and caused other organs of the body, the blood vessels, to dilate. So for erectile dysfunction or to make the penis stay engorged longer, these products were used. It was also thought to relax the anal sphincter. So this became a common popular use among young men through the 1950s and 60s.
Right. So specifically, was paupers use more common among gay men who were the receptive partner in anal intercourse?
We don't have any evidence to document that. But so some, I mean, much of this use was basically on dance floors. But some people that used it with sex, of course, it'd be open in a room, or I can't say that we have evidence that specific gay men used it more often. You could conjecture that, but I can't document that.
Okay. Now, there was amongst gay men an anti-paupers movement, and I'm sure you know the names Hank Wilson and John Lauritsen. I mean, did you get to know these people who were advocating against the use of poppers?
Yeah, I got to know. I met John Larson, but yeah, I became good friends with Hank Wilson over the years. And Hank was really one of the activists that ended up getting the laws passed. But let's go back. Let's go back. You said I started my research on poppers when I was at NIID.
Mm-hmm.
That's not exactly correct. And I actually stumbled onto poppers.
Okay.
So I was at CDC in 1981. As I mentioned, I was probably the most clinically trained of the people that initially worked on that, having done internal medicine and infectious diseases and just gotten off the wards to come down to CDC. So they actually asked me to make up the definition for AIDS. And then I got involved in the initial case control study, where we went out and interviewed gay men with AIDS and gay men without AIDS in October of 1981. We did that in four cities, in New York City, Atlanta, San Francisco, and Los Angeles. I spent the month in New York City. And so from that study, which included 39 men with Kaposi sarcoma, 8 men with pneumocystis alone, and then 3 men who had both Kaposi's and pneumocystis. So it was predominantly among Kaposi's patients as opposed to pneumocystis patients. We found that the biggest difference was numbers of sexual partners and meeting those partners in bathhouses, suggesting that it was some new infectious agent and not... There were actually 4 hypotheses we went into that first study with. 1, cytomegalovirus. That was the leading hypothesis of what caused AIDS back in 1981 from Giraldo's work on Kaposi sarcoma and Mike Gottlieb's work finding cytomegalovirus in all 5 of his cases. We could find evidence of cytomegalovirus in many of the early cases. But it turns out that we could not find a new strain or a mutation of cytomegalovirus. The second hypothesis was poppers. Well, we found that gay men with AIDS used more poppers than gay men without AIDS back in 1981.
Mm-hmm.
But that difference was not as great as the difference in of numbers of partners and meeting partners in bathhouses from the logistic regression, the sophisticated statistical analysis we did. The third hypothesis was that this was basically an overload of the immune system, that, you know, people were exposed to syphilis and gonorrhea and influenza and cytomegalovirus.
And antibiotics.
There was some evidence, there were some slight increases of treatments for giardiasis or but again, these didn't hold up in the final analysis. And then the fourth was that there was some new agent out there, either another herpes virus or another hepatitis virus, or even retroviruses were mentioned as we did that first study back in 1981. Now, how I got into poppers was we did 3 follow-up studies after the first study. There was a guy named David Auerbach, who was an EIF officer like me in Los Angeles, who interviewed the Los Angeles cases. He noticed that some of his patients that he interviewed said they had sex with some of the other patients that he interviewed in the case control study. And so he and a sociologist from CDC went out and were able to connect like 40 different gay men with AIDS across 10 different cities and published their result. That became somewhat famous. There's a diagram and a patient. There's still now debate now whether they call them patient zero or patient O outside of California. An airline.
That was the Canadian.
Canadian airline steward, right.
Yes.
So that was one of the first follow-up studies. And so, again, that provided more evidence that this was really a sexually transmitted agent, as opposed to something else. Another study was done by Mary Guinan, and she then took those patients that said they weren't gay and did interviews of them and blood samples, et cetera, and found very little cytomegalovirus in that group, and also almost no popper use among the non-gay cases of AIDS. And then the third study was the one that I and Peter Drottman started, where we said, you know, we've got 39 cases with Kaposi sarcoma. We need more pneumocystis patients. And let's see if there's a difference between gay men who develop Kaposi's from gay men who develop pneumocystis. And also look at those cases that develop Kaposi's and pneumocystis and see if there's differences across those groups. And indeed, when we looked at that, we ended up with 87 patients that we interviewed, all gay men. Most of them, it turns out 47 of the 87 had Kaposi's alone, 20 had pneumocystis alone, and 20 had both. When we did the analysis for that, we found that there was a single factor that differentiated gay men with Kaposi's from gay men with pneumocystis, and it was poppers.
Hmm.
So that's how we got into poppers. So here I'm an infectious disease guy. I get a result totally unexpected from our analysis.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And we got those results. So we did that study. We interviewed the patients and did the analysis. I think we closed enrollment in October of 82 and had our results by the summer of 83.
So now you've kind of got a competing hypothesis. For you're saying that poppers are important, but obviously the new virus theory was gaining steam at that time.
That's correct. Yeah, the French came out with their virus, LAV, lymphadenopathy-associated virus. They found early in 1983 and published their work in May of 83. Gallo was the second group to find a retrovirus, which he then published in May of 84.
Mm-hmm.
We at CDC were the third group to report finding a retrovirus in July of 84, and in addition, our study from blood transfusion cases, we found the same virus in a blood donor and a blood recipient, further supporting Koch's postulates for HIV as a cause of AIDS. And then the fourth group was San Francisco, Jay Levy's laboratory, who found the same virus, basically, in gay men, both with AIDS and those that with lymphadenopathy and with asymptomatic gay men.
But you continued to study poppers in the association with KS and AIDS for some time, including after you went to NIDA, and I'm not so sure about the timeline.
I'm still looking at poppers and KS and exploring the association in China right now. And I think one of my most recent observations is we talked about this guy, T. Lauder Brunton, who discovered clinical use of poppers or amyl nitrite, in 1867, it turns out he ends up studying physiology as a postdoc at the University of Vienna, starting in 1868 and 1869, at the same time that Maurice Kaposi's is seeing his first cases of Kaposi sarcoma on the clinical wards at the University of Vienna.
That's a pretty interesting coincidence.
It is a pretty interesting coincidence, don't you think? Now, I can't document that T. Lauder Brunton ever met Maurice Kaposi, or that they ever saw the same patients, but is it possible that these hospitalized patients at Vienna in their late 60s had chest pains, and were being experimented on with amyl nitrite.
That certainly seems like a plausible hypothesis. It's
There you go. Well,
it's sad. It's sad that, you know, you can't go back and ask people questions about what was going on, because a lot of stuff
yes,
is lost.
Or even get their medical records to see if indeed they had.
See if we can get a copy of their laptop.
Yeah, there you go. I mean, if I don't know if you've seen many dermatology notes, but Kaposi, you know, I'm sure wrote a short little note describing basically the skin lesion. You know, mm-hmm. did he take a history about heart disease? You know, whatever. So it's fast. It's coincidence.
I mean, when there's a cause that's outside of your kind of scope, you probably won't even ask the questions that would reveal that, right? Just like you were surprised by the entrance of paupers into the whole thing. I mean, you managed to you didn't miss that, but it would be very easy to miss something, because what would, what goes on the dance floor have to do with somebody showing up, a gay man showing up with a disease in a doctor's office?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So what did you find about the health effects of paupers? Like, you at NIDA, you published a large monograph, which was not all your own papers, but I think you organized a meeting, brought in a lot of experts on paupers each person provided a paper on their thoughts about nitrites and the health effects. But, you know, overall, what did you find about the negative health effects of paupers? I guess there was positive health effects too, but that's not really the concern.
Well, so I leave CDC in 84. I get recruited to go up to NIAID, mainly because of my work with pneumocystis. I actually did some work looking at the treatments for pneumocystis. And so NIAID was really responsible for developing treatments for the opportunistic infections. So they recruited me up in 84, and I helped set up the first AIDS clinical trials group, tested as different drugs came through. Eventually, AZT came through even before I left in some of the right the end studies of that. But we looked at other agents. I got involved in animal models of infection looking at the natural history of the cohorts of gay men that NIAID started. And then in September of 1986, I get a call from NIDA, from the National Institute on Drug Abuse, which was actually not part of NIH at the time. It was part of another agency called Alcohol, Drug Abuse, and Mental Health Administration, ADMHA, which included the both research and service provisions for mental health, alcohol abuse, and alcoholism, and drug abuse. And so I went over, they called me up and invited me to apply for a position there. I applied for the position, and then, of course, had to get clearance from the Public Health Service to transfer from NIAID to NIDA, which I did. And then I get there in December, and there was a law passed in October of 86 asking NIDA to do a survey of paupers and tell us, is there any relationship between paupers and AIDS?
Mm-hmm.
I think that law was put in place through the activity of Hank Wilson, an activist in San Francisco, who, as you mentioned, had a big concern about paupers, and his congressman, Mel Levine. And so I get to NIDA, and I'm only there 2 weeks. I get called into an emergency meeting to respond to Congress. And so the head of NIDA asks, is there anybody who will volunteer to put on to do this work? to tell us about poppers. So, of course, I raise my hand, and then I'm able to call a meeting. I remember it was March 31st, 1987, which actually is the same day that Ronald Reagan and the French Prime Minister Chirac signed an agreement about HIV and the blood tests and the royalties.
The official history of the discovery of HIV
might not have been
completely a true history, but it worked for the U.S. and French governments.
Right, right. Well, we can have a whole another session.
That would be a whole different discussion.
but a very interesting topic, which I've written about as well. But so I have this meeting, and yeah, the meeting we had 10 presenters, and so I had everybody, the 10 presenters, present their results, and I put it out as a monograph.
Right.
I don't know if I've sent you the monograph.
I have a copy.
Yeah. So
it's online now.
Yeah, it's online. It's you can get it on Amazon. I think it was a government. But anyway, yeah, it lists the side effects. We talked about fires. I mean, we talked about people who would have respiratory problems, people they'd have vasodilatation, which would cause them to faint. Some people collapsed. There were people that drank these fluids, children who died. So there were a lot of, and of course, skin lesions. And then, of course, I made the connection. Some other people looked in the laboratory and showed that nitrites were actually carcinogenic in different in vitro systems. Mm-hmm. They affected the immune system. They depressed immunity in both humans and in mice and other things. So there was a lot of evidence to suggest that there were health hazards due to the use of these poppers.
Right.
And there was some connection to the cancer.
Mm-hmm.
So with this, I put out this government publication in August of 1988, and Hank Wilson again. Now, I can't communicate directly with Congress, at my level, but Hank Wilson took my monograph and mailed it to all 535 congressmen in the United States, 100 senators and 435 congressmen around the country. And the next month, they put together a law, an add-on onto a law, banning butyl nitrites.
Mm-hmm.
So, of course, the nitrite industry goes berserk, and they change and make isopropyl, and they add a couple of carbons, and the U.S. government goes back in, Mel Levine and Hank Wilson and others, and they altered the law 2 years later to say you couldn't manufacture and sell alkyl nitrites, so branch chain. So what did the companies do? They made the cation end into circles, into rings, cyclohexyl, cyclopentyl nitrites, which are now legal. But they're not branch chains.
Right. How did the usage of poppers in the gay community change over time? I mean, did Hank Wilson and John Lauritsen and other anti-poppers activists and all the laws and things have any impact, at least on raising awareness of the health dangers, or did things just go on pretty much uninterrupted?
I think as I look at it, so we can do surveys. So the MAC study, a cohort study set up by NIAID and NCI, in the 83-84, which has continued to survey gay men and do physical exams and immunologic studies and HIV studies and drug abuse, there's been a marked decrease pretty much right after these laws were affected. More so in Pittsburgh and Chicago and Baltimore than in San Francisco or Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have a cohort in New York. Now, my sense is, seeing is that still in the coastal areas, there's still significant popper use. And the popper industry was very creative. Right before these laws went into effect, they were starting to get mailing lists. And so even though they moved the manufacturer off the Caribbean islands, they can still direct and mail these to people who request them. So,
and they were marketed in what you might call a homoerotic way, right? The names of the poppers. I mean, all these different bottles contain pretty much the same stuff, but they were given names that you know, if you thought about gay sex, kind of were related to it, like Rush and Iron Horse,
right,
or something
exactly.
Like that.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And they're still named that, but you know, it's interesting. So the law said they banned manufacture and sale unless for legitimate commercial use.
Mm-hmm.
And so they didn't really want to stop if there were cardiologists that still wanted to use amyl nitrite.
Mm-hmm.
For a medical use, and there's actually it's actually still used as a treatment for acute cyanide poisoning.
Okay.
So there are some legitimate uses of amyl nitrite.
Well, they were also marketed as like video head cleaners and room deodorizers and things, which they obviously
exactly.
weren't.
Now I was actually just up in New York City a couple of weeks ago having lunch with Marcus Conant,
mm-hmm.
the San Francisco dermatologist who first reported some of the cases. And he and I went to lunch in Chelsea basically so he could walk me around the corner to one of these head shops, and indeed on this display is Rush and Hardware and all these poppers. And I picked up the bottles and I looked at them, and they're all for nail polish removers.
Nail polish removers. And they're selling them in shops that cater to gay men. I mean, I guess some gay men use nail polish, but I don't think the majority do.
Right,
anyway.
Video head cleaners, I mean, that was, it used to be. Room
right.
odorizers.
They certainly...
You know, there used to be. But they now actually... So it was very interesting to see these. My observation is the bottles are half the size they were in the 80s at 3 to 4 times the price.
Right.
And now they do have on there, they include butyl nitrite, which is illegal, and iso or cyclopentyl nitrite alcohols.
Mm.
So they do. They've changed the labeling, but right. They're basically the same products. Now,
before we end, because we're getting close to the end of our time, I wanted to. You had in one of your presentations a nice graph of the trends in the occurrence of Kaposi sarcoma from 1973 to 2001. You didn't have a source in the presentation. I'm just wondering where you got that data from, and what were the trends in Kaposi sarcoma from the start of the AIDS era, or 1973, even before that, to 2001?
Well, I think you can see. So that data is from 1973, and the source of that data is a NCI surveillance system, the Surveillance and End Results, Surveillance Epidemiology and End Results Survey, the SEER data, SEER data, where the NCI has collected data from 10 sites in the country, 5 cities and 5 states. Where they've done quite a bit of education looking at death certificates. And so taking death certificates in which Kaposi sarcoma is listed, 40 different cancers they survey and mark them out over time. And you can see that there were about, as I mentioned earlier, from 1973 to 81, about 30 cases a year reported to SEER. And that number skyrocketed, 81 to about 88, 89. And then after the laws were put into effect, and of course at about the same time we developed AZT and some of the other antiretrovirals, the number of cases has declined, and we're back down, not quite to 30 per year in that, but back toward a lower rate being reported than there was in the 1980s.
Yes. Well, one thing we haven't had time to get into, and we might need to have another conversation sometime, was the issue of causality and the competition between HIV, maybe I shouldn't say competition, the various roles of HIV, paupers, and Kaposi sarcoma herpes virus, or HHV8, in the development of Kaposi sarcoma. And also your ideas about, you know, what's causing Kaposi sarcoma in other places, because some of the information you provided on Africans is kind of counterintuitive in terms of what the risk factors are for Kaposi sarcoma. They're kind of the opposite of what I would have thought would be likely. But we don't have time to get into the whole causality argument, although it's very important.
Well, let's set up another time, maybe in a couple of weeks. And
sure,
we can go through that because I think it's a very interesting history, and I think Kaposi sarcoma is caused by multiple factors. It's quite complex. It's going to be difficult to prove, but I think if this cancer, if it's indeed a cancer, is multifactorial, there may be other cancers
that are
multifactorial, like cervical cancer and some of the HPV-related cancers, the hepatitis-related cancers. Maybe there are other factors there as well.
Yes, I think so, and I think it's probably interesting to people that this is still up for debate. How many years is it now since 1981? It's a lot of years.
Yeah, next year it'll be 40 years.
40 years.
You know?
That we're still debating, you know, what causes Kaposi sarcoma. Is it one thing or multiple things, and how do they interact? I would just like to thank you so much for joining me today. It's fascinating from both the historical and scientific point of view, and I appreciate you sharing your knowledge and your experiences with us.
Hey, well, thanks for having me.
Okay, we'll talk again.
Take care.
Goodbye, Harry.
Uh-huh. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you for listening to episode 242 of The Infectious Myth. If you have a comment, question, or suggestion for a future guest, please email me at david.crow@theinfectiousmyth.com. Like us at facebook.com/theinfectiousmyth or join the discussion there. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Infectious Myth. Commit to monthly donations of any amount to Infectious Myth on patreon.com or liberapay.com. Until next week, thank you. And goodbye.